So my talk is about macro architectural trends. What I'll talk about is a little bit about architectural issues in different aspects of the system architecture, including processor, memory, and the networking subsystem. I will not go into too much detail into that. There are more talks that go in some sort of a deep dive into these architectural trends. What I'm really looking to do is give a broad perspective of what these three pieces are, how they play with each other, and I'll talk a little bit about where we are today, but I'll focus mostly on where we are going towards, where we are planning to get to in the next 10 years or so. So I'm a computer scientist at Argonne. I work mainly on MPI, but this talk is not about MPI. Just want to give a brief picture. Many of you have already seen this, hopefully. This is the picture from the top 500 chart of where the fastest supercomputers in the world are heading towards, okay? Every 11 years or so, we see a 1,000-fold increase in performance, okay? This performance is measured by the Linpack benchmark, but the important thing to note is that a few years ago, we were at a teraflop. We went to a petaflop in 2007-ish. By around 2018, the hope was that we'll get to exaflop, which is 10 power 18 floating point operations per second. In between, 100 petaflop machine was supposed to come out in 2015. It's more likely to come out in 2016 at this point. But that's essentially every 11 years, we will see a massive jump in performance. Now, this increase in performance is mostly driven by scientific computing needs, right? All your simulations and weather forecasting and climate modeling and all that stuff is driving these needs to get to these large machines. But the important thing we have to remember is that these simulations by themselves are not the market drivers, okay? HPC in itself is a very, very tiny market. So it by itself cannot drive what industry needs to sustain themselves. Intel cannot survive just by selling HPC machines, okay? Only machines suitable for scientific computing. It just can't do that, okay? It has to make its money by selling processors for laptops, for tablets, the new ones, and so on, okay? That's where its money is. HPC has to utilize what the industry is doing for the mass market, for the commodity market, and maybe make a few tweaks to make it helpful for the scientific computing applications, okay? That, we have to keep that in mind, okay? I'll be talking about that a bit more later. There are some exceptions. Cray, for example, mostly survives on scientific computing systems. It's debatable if it's making a profit, but that's one of the exceptions you'll see. But it's not a general trend for most industry. And for the past 2 decades or so, commodity hardware has been the driver. Hardware innovation was mostly for desktop or more recently laptop and tablet type of machines. And a few HPC specific pieces were there that were essentially putting these together. Okay, you take things that were developed for the desktop and put these together using, let's say, a fast network like Mirnet and Quadrex, where the older networks, InfiniBand is kind of a newer network. ECC memory, desktops typically don't care so much about ECC memory, but that's something the HPC market has been pushing for. Okay, so if you look at the high-end computing systems today, the technology, the scientific needs, okay, what we need from the scientific community has been driving this, and we have already put together a bunch of huge machines. We crossed the petaflop barrier a few years ago. The Tianhe 1A machine, the Roadrunner machine at Los Alamos was one of the first petaflop machine, but then they were followed by other petaflop scale machines, the Tianhe 1A, Oak Ridge Jaguar. Then we went to the next stage of order of 10 petaflop machines. Argonne has a big BlueGene Q system. Pete showed a picture of that called Mira. The other bigger machines, Lawrence Livermore has a 20 petaflop machine. The Chinese put together a 33 petaflop machine just this June. And the exaflop machine will be out in 2018, 2020. But it's a big jump from where we are today, right? We are at 20, 30 petaflop today. We are jumping to an exaflop machine, which means the amount of change is going to be drastic when we go from the current generation to this next generation of machines. That could mean a lot more processors, different types of memory, different types of interconnect, We have to deal with issues of management and reliability. Pete mentioned a little bit about this. And many of these hardware challenges have to be addressed, but the important thing we have to do is we have to address this without making it extremely difficult for programmers to use these machines. Okay? The real requirement for these machines is scientific computing. Okay? If you make these machines so difficult that none of the application developers, none of the domain scientists can use it, it's not going to be worth the investment. So we have to do, we have to meet these architectural requirements without making the programmability of the systems too much more difficult than where we are today. It's kind of a given that it'll be a little bit more difficult, but hopefully not too much more. And feel free to stop me at any time. You don't have to wait till the end. So before I talk about the trends, upcoming trends, let me look back on what were drivers at each of these steps. Okay, we went to terascale, we went to petascale, and now we are looking at exascale. What were the drivers at each of these levels? Okay, before we reach terascale, computational power just make faster processors, right? Keep increasing your clock speed, everything will work fine. That is all great. When we reach terascale, networking models and debuggers became a big challenge. We have thousands of these processors. How do we connect these processes together? The network requirements became a big issue. How do we debug applications when we have 1,000 processes on the system? Okay, that was a major issue. Performance tools was another major issue that became a big challenge in the terascale era. That was a challenge. People addressed it. New tools developed, new networks developed, everything worked great. Went to petascale. The next challenge came up, which was concurrency. Okay. That was concurrency within the node mainly, which is the multi-core era, where each processor no longer had a single core. It had 4, 8 cores that are being used simultaneously for the application. Okay. Commodity market was a late arriver into this, but it was still one of the drivers for these this trend of concurrency. The next step of going to exascale computers, the big driver, debatably, the only driver is the energy usage of the systems. Okay, I'll talk about how this single one single driver of the energy, the power consumption of the system, essentially is has its fingers into every single architectural design. Okay, how you design your processors is somehow related to energy. Okay, you have to keep the energy down. How you design your memory is related to energy. How you design your networks is related to energy. Okay, so everything somehow goes back to this one point of how do we keep the energy budget in place. Okay, I'll talk a little bit more about energy before talking about the architectural trends. Okay, so this is the slide I borrowed from Kathy, but she borrowed it from someone else, so this has been going around for many, many years now. These numbers are a little out of date at this point, but at least it gives a trend. Okay, so if you look at the system peak, at 2010, we were at 2 petaflop. We're now at 30 petaflop. In 2015, 2016, we expect to get to 200, 300 petaflop. 2018, that number has shifted to 2020, and now 2022, I guess, we'll reach an exaflop machine. Okay, but that increase is what, 500x increase in performance? But if you look at the power line, you're going from around 6 megawatts to 20 to 30 megawatts. Okay, not that much increase in power. Okay. Now, what we are essentially asking architects to do is to build 1,000 times faster machine by using 10 times more power. Okay, approximately. Right. Now that is a tough nut to crack. Okay. Now that essentially determines every single picojoule. You have to be careful about how I spend this. Where should I use this? Can I build a processor this way? If I have two options, one option is a superior processor, one option is a more power efficient processor, almost certainly I'll pick the more power efficient one because it's, you know, I'm power constrained at this point. So we have to keep this in mind, okay. This is a report Peter had written up a few years ago, which talks about the costs of the power issues with respect to these exascale systems. In some sense, you can think of it as a cost as two costs. One is the upfront cost, how much you build, how much the cost, how much money does it take to build the machine? And the second cost is how much money does it take to keep the machine up, okay, to keep the machine powered up. Okay. A general rule of thumb is that for every megawatt of power, you spend about $1 million, okay, per year. Okay. Which means if I build a machine of 20 megawatt, which uses 20 megawatts of power, I'm spending, my electricity bill is $20 million. Okay. That's not including the cooling costs, of course, and they're not including the building cost and the, you know, the air supply, air duct, all that costs. Okay. Just the electricity bill for keeping the machine on is going to be $20 million for a 20 megawatt machine. So that is already becoming the major cost of the system. The system acquisition cost is becoming a tiny fraction of this overall system cost, and most of the cost is going into keeping the machine up. Okay, so that is the trend we are trying to address. Okay. So with that backdrop, I'll talk about three things: the processor architecture, the memory architecture, and the network architecture. I'll spend lesser time on the memory architecture because I think there's another talk later on that. And I'll talk about two things. One is where we are today and what changes are happening to get to the next generation of machines. And two, how that relates to both the energy power usage as well as how that relates to the commodity market. Okay. So I kind of stole this slide from one of Pete's previous talks. This is a chip architecture of the BlueJean Q supercomputer at Argonne, okay, Livermore as well. And if you look at these processors, so it's a known fact, BlueJean Q has 16 cores for doing its computation and one extra core for doing, you know, running the operating system and other things. But if you look at the number of cores over here, PU0 to PU17, that's 18 cores, okay? It's not 17, it's 18, okay? What happened to that missing core, okay? This is just an example of many processors that do this, okay? Systems are, processors are increasingly putting more and more silicon onto the chip, but not powering it on. Okay, two reasons for that. One is reliability. If a core goes down, you can use that extra core that's sitting there and power it back on. And second reason is that it's too expensive with respect to power if I have to turn on everything on the chip. Okay, now the die area is reaching a trend where I can put 100 cores on a processor, on a chip, okay? But I don't have, the thermal design point of the processor is not high enough that I can turn on all these 100 cores at the same time right now, okay? So we have to keep this trend in mind. So just because I can put in a core, I can squeeze in a core onto a chip, does not mean that I have enough power to turn it on, okay? It has other reliability constraints as well, which I'll not talk about over here. Other issues is with respect to liquid cooling. This is water cooled, these aluminum pipes over here, they use all water cooling systems, which are becoming increasingly important because of the amount of power, amount of heat that these processors generate if you have to keep all this turned on. Okay. Now, important issue is the cooling system. There is a huge amount of papers that are coming out recently with respect to how do I cool these, keep these systems cooled down. I don't have a picture, but Supermicro just released a machine this June, which puts the entire system, okay, entire processor, immersed in some sort of oil, okay, and it's a great cooling system. They had to do large simulations to show how this oil interacts with, you know, the processor. If you have to make sure that the circuitry doesn't burn because you immersed it in a liquid, okay? They have this huge run of simulations and they just released a system where the entire system is immersed in a liquid, okay? So if you see, they have this cool transparent cabinet and the liquid, you see all of that flowing. It's amazing. Okay, I'm not sure if it works, but they just released it and they have done a lot of testing for that. That's not the only system. There are going to be more and more systems that are going to come out this way. The Cray system, the early Cray systems used to be immersed in liquid nitrogen, okay? So it's not a new technology. It's just that old technology is coming back today because we are not, we have to find ways to keep the cooling costs low, in some sense, to reduce the amount of heat that's dissipated out of these processes. Okay. Concurrency is a key piece of this technology trends. If you look at this graph, shows it's slightly old, it's only till June 2011. It shows with respect to the maximum performance of the top supercomputer, the red line over there, and the number of cores used on the top supercomputer on those systems. Okay, we see two trends over here. The maximum performance, of course, has been keeps on growing, but the number of cores, till a certain point, has been more or less constant. Okay. The concurrency in the system was not growing significantly as we increased the performance. Okay, but after a certain point, we hit a wall. Okay, we can no longer increase the performance just by increasing the clock speeds, and now we are in a trend, upward trend, where the number of cores increases almost linearly with the performance, with the maximum performance of the system. This is a short-lived curve. In the future, we expect that the number of cores will increase even faster than the performance. So you need, if you want to double your performance, you have to increase the number of cores by more than twice if you have to get double the performance. Okay, so we are going to see this trend even more going forward. Okay, let's look at the processor architectures. Two kind of parallel designs are happening with respect to processor architectures. Both of those are driven mainly by that one constraint, okay? Too much energy, okay? We have to restrict the amount of power or energy used by these processors. And there are two parallel designs that are happening, and both of these are essentially addressing that one constraint of power energy. The first design that's happening is more the IBM type of view of systems. Both the BlueJean systems as well as the server series, like the EX4, EX5 type of server series, their view is that I have the system and I can put a lot more cores on the system, but in order to keep the power usage down, I have to cut down on something else. Okay, so what they do is they duplicate the cores or the threads on the cores, but they don't duplicate the entire logic circuitry that goes with that. For example, they don't always duplicate the amount of cache. They don't always duplicate every unit on the chip, every floating point unit, every instruction decoder. They don't replicate this. So what this is leading to is an architecture where you have this hierarchy. Okay, so you have each, let's say, quote unquote, node. Now, node is becoming a very abstract concept. It's no longer like a desktop sitting with a cabinet or something. Okay, but let's say some abstract concept of node has multiple cache coherent domains. Okay. Each cache coherent domain has multiple sockets, okay, possibly NUMA. Okay, so each cache coherent domain, think of it as a set of memory and a bunch of processors which are cache coherent, right? Each memory domain has a bunch of sockets, right? Sockets where you plug in your processor chips. Each socket can have multiple dies packaged together. This you would see in the AMD Bulldozer machine. You have two dies pasted together and stuck onto the same socket. Each die can have multiple cores, and each core can have multiple threads. Okay, so this huge level of hierarchy is coming up on all these processors, and what this hierarchy means is that at every step of this hierarchy, I am losing parallelism. I'm losing some units. Okay, when I go from multiple hardware threads to multiple cores, they might share the same cache. Okay, L1 cache, let's say. When I go from multiple cores to the same multiple dies on the same socket, I might lose my connectivity to the memory controllers. I might have two different connectivities per die. When I go from multiple dies to multiple sockets, I might lose something else, and then maybe the connection to the network. Okay, it might be far away, further away from me. Okay, so each step I go, I have more and more hardware sharing. Okay, so just because you have more arithmetic units sitting on that processor does not mean that your performance would go up by the same amount. Okay? It depends on what your application is doing. If your application is only crunching flops, nothing else, then of course 1,000 cores, 1,000 hardware threads means 1,000x performance. But if your application is using, let's say, some cache, it's using a little bit of memory, it is sending some data over the network, every time you go down this hierarchy, that part is shared, which means that part of your performance is not increasing anymore. Okay? So that trend we have to keep in mind. And of course, all this reason why we are putting all this in together is because of better, denser packaging. Okay, we want to keep these things as close to each other, because when I want to send data from one hardware thread to another hardware thread, the distance is much lesser than having to send from one machine to another machine across the room. Okay, the amount of distance reduces, which means the better packaging, denser packaging, means lesser distance to travel, which means lesser energy. Okay, so this trend is essentially coming because of that constraint of energy. A node itself is a very abstract concept. For example, in the EX4, a node is a collection of a bunch of essentially motherboards. Okay, so they are cache coherent domain. They have a single OS for each motherboard. Okay, so they have, you can think of it as one node in your traditional desktop sense, but they put all these motherboards together into a single cabinet. So that's one swim lane. The other swim lane people are looking at are heterogeneous processor architectures. Okay, so the idea is, we have, why do we need the same type of processors, cores, all through the system? For some pieces of the application, one type of core might be better. For other pieces of application, another core might be better. Okay, GPUs are an example of that. Okay, the GPU itself is not heterogeneous, but if you think of a CPU and a GPU together, all of you over here know what GPUs are, don't you? Anyone not know what a GPU is? Okay, all right. So these together form some form of heterogeneity. Okay. Now think of it. Think of it as your cell phone, right? Where's my cell phone? My cell phone. Right? The processor on this is very, very weak, very slow, right? But when I do my animation, when I play a game on my cell phone, it works pretty much as well as on my laptop or on my server. Okay. Why is that? The reason is that the processor it uses for playing games is not quite the same as the processor it uses for running the operating system. They figured out, the cell phone companies figured out, that the games are much better utilized on a graphics processor, right? When I do my animations, when I scroll on my iPhone, that animation is much better done on the GPU, and there is no reason for me to use a regular processor for that, and hence use more energy, more power, trying to run a regular game on a regular processor. That model is true even for regular scientific computing. Okay, so a lot of these graphics, today you can find a lot of systems that use graphics processing units plugged in to your node, so that you can have both the CPU and the GPU that are executing at the same time on the same node, and the application can use both of them simultaneously. Now, you have to make some changes, because there are two different types of processors. The CPU is good for some things, like for example, it's very good for irregular computations where you need more cache, you need more control units, and so on. The graphics processor is good for something else, where you can use massive parallelism and all of them go in the same locked time step, where everything executes instructions at the same time, okay? More or less. Okay, so as we go towards it, now GPU is just an example. Okay, it's a current model of where things go. But in the future, you can think of it as the same processor, one single chip, having both quote unquote general purpose cores as well as accelerator cores. Or thinking even further out, you can think of one single chip having five different types of cores, each set of cores being specialized for one form of computation. Okay, so that's the heterogeneous computing to the extreme. Okay, specialization is extremely important, because specialization allows you to do the same amount of work with lesser energy, as long as what you're trying to do matches what that cores are specialized for. Okay, so also important to note that specialization also means that you are giving up some things. Okay, if you run a computation which is not, if you're running a computation on a core that is not specialized for that computation, you're actually using more energy, more power trying to do the same computation. So you have to be careful. It's a double-edged sword. You can't just throw in a bunch of accelerator cores and assume that the entire application will work beautifully. That's not going to happen. Okay? You have to be careful of how you partition your work for each of these things. Okay? These are some of the things that you might miss out. Like you might have no snooping hardware for cache coherence. You might not have implicit caches that we kind of enjoy on our Intel and AMD processors. Okay? We might have to explicitly manage our caches through scratchpad memory. You might not have floating point units replicated all over and so on. Would floating point operations suffer if you have more GPUs? Now, the point over here was GPU is just an example of this. What I was referring to is specialization of processors. So you can think of a specialization where you replicate the number of integer units, okay, 1,000 integer units, which all share a single floating point unit. Okay, so don't get stuck up on the fact about the floating point units. It's whatever hardware is not replicated across each processing unit, if you use that hardware intensively, the performance is going to suffer. So the hardware is customized for a specific type of computation. If I have 1,000 integer units replicated, it is specialized for integer intensive applications. Okay? If you have a floating point computation on that, of course that will suffer. Okay? It's a shared thing. There's some cases where it's not true because cache coherence can be with respect to some domains, smaller domains. Okay? It is true that when you build 1,000 core machines, it is true that the entire system might not be cache coherent. Okay? That's a given. Okay? However, it also does not mean to the extreme that every single core is non-cache coherent with each other. Okay? For example, even if you look at the Intel SEC system, each core is non-cache coherent, but it is coherent with a network adapter. Okay, so if the network sends in data, it will flush the cache and so on. So we have to assume that there'll be a change, but it might not always go to the extreme. Nothing is cache coherent. And of course, the most likely possibility is a combination of the two. I'm not going to talk too much about this, but the idea is that you might have both forms sitting on a single machine. You might have something like, you know, regular cores that are hierarchical in nature. We have cores, threads, and so on. Then you have some form of heterogeneity, most likely accelerator cores, but I wouldn't just count on only having accelerator cores. There might be some other forms of specialization as well, which all mix together, some form of, you know, large cores, small cores combinations is what we might expect to see in the future. Okay. One important concern, we don't see this quite too often in scientific computing talks, so I'm trying to make it a point to mention this in this talk. One concern many researchers are having in the next generation of, when we're talking about exaflop machines, is that there is a big and increasing divide in what the commodity market needs and what we are seeing vendors trying to develop for scientific computing. Okay, so let me remind everyone, HPC is not an economic driver. Okay, HPC itself cannot sustain a company. Okay, they have to make their money by selling whatever technology they develop, or at least a variant of the technology, to the mass market. Okay, so one concern, it's a debate, open debate, but some researchers think that there is a divide between what the commodity market needs and what the scientific computing is pushing the technology market towards. Okay. For example, if you have a huge hierarchy of architectures, okay, will the gamers, will people who are buying the tablets, will they need that? Okay. If I have lesser caches, if I have explicitly managed caches, will the gamers, will the tablet market, will the cell phone market be willing to pay for developing these technologies? Okay. Do they care about this enough? Okay. There are some pieces like, you know, accelerators, GPUs, that the cell phone market cares about because, you know, you want to play games on your cell phone. Okay. That part they care about. But will they care about ECC? That's for error protection of the memory, single bit error protection. Okay. Now, some vendors are thinking about double bit protection. There's technology to develop that through explicit redundancy. There is technology to deal with double or triple bit errors as well. But it's just too expensive. Okay, if you think that even ECC, the mass market is not going to pay for, will anyone pay for double bit protection, double bit error protection on the memory? Okay, so we have to think about this a little carefully and to see where the trend is going, and more importantly, will the mass market support this trend? Okay, will they pay for this trend? HPC in itself cannot pay for this trend. Okay, it's too big, and HPC market is too small to pay for these trends. Okay, so we have to get support from the rest of the community. So I talked a little bit of specialization. I should have put this slide earlier, but specialization, people are thinking of more and more specialization on the processor. To an extreme, I talk about the Andrew Chen's work on 10x10. The idea is that if I can have the processor subdivided into multiple pieces, and each piece would be specialized for a small part of the application computation. Now this is you know, forward thinking a little bit, because that assumes that you can have a gazillion specialized units on your processor, and you can switch between these processor units, you know, very fast through power gating techniques or whatever else, because we already know that the thermal design point, the power envelope of the chip, is not large enough to keep all of this powered on at the same time. Okay, so we have to keep a few of them turned on at the same time and switch between them rapidly to be able to achieve that performance. That's a little bit forward thinking, but there is good reason to believe that an architecture like this might be possible because of the new technologies of power gating, which says that I can quickly turn off or gate the power to some units and turn on other units. So it is possible to think that something like this might be possible in the future. Okay, that was with respect to the processor. Let's talk a little bit about memory. AMD Fusion was one architecture which was had the accelerator cores and the general purpose regular core sitting on the same chip. It is true, that is an example architecture that is already out, but that's mostly for the desktop market. AMD is pushing hard to have an equivalent for the server market, for the scientific computing market. So are other companies. So in the future, we expect that the same chip will have multiple accelerator cores. So none of this is with respect to GPUs. GPU is just an example of heterogeneity in the node, not on the chip. All right, with respect to memory, memory is probably one of the most important aspects with respect to keeping the power, maintaining the power of the system, okay? If the cost of the system-wise, today, it's estimated, it depends on the system, of course, but approximately half the system cost comes from just the memory, okay? The acquisition cost, okay? Now, with respect to keeping the memory on, now that is another aspect of its own. Right now, memory technologies are very inefficient in the way they deal with byte access, okay? It's DRAM, okay? You're supposed to have random access to memory, any byte in the memory architecture, but in reality, that's not true with respect to the power, okay? The way the architectures are laid out today is that you cannot just light up the one byte that you want to access. You have to light up a larger portion of the memory, even if you have to access just one byte in that portion of the memory. So there are technologies that are trying to look at how these will change with respect to minimizing the amount of memory that I have to power on in order to retrieve a single byte of memory. Okay. If you are having contiguous access to memory, if you're accessing memory one of each byte after the other, then you probably don't care about this too much, but when your memory accesses become irregular, you take a byte from here, you take a byte from there, if you have to power on, let's say, an entire page every time you access a byte of memory, that becomes really expensive. Okay, so that there are some technologies that are looking into that as well. One important point I want to bring up, this was mentioned in the previous talk with respect to data movement. I just want to give a little few statistics that explain this a little bit more. Okay, if you look at the trend today, okay, cost of moving data, okay, just take a byte, move it from one point to point A to point B. Okay, now the cost of moving data for a millimeter is about 6 picojoules. Okay, so approximately. Okay, this is from a previous report. Things might have changed at this point, but just gives you an idea. Okay, today and the future, okay? 20 millimeter, 120 picojoules. A flop cost is going to drop significantly today compared to what we'll have in the future, okay? Now, relatively, these costs, you'll already see that the flop cost today is more expensive, but in the future, the flop cost is going to be a tiny fraction of the data movement cost, okay? So in some sense, you can think of it as 10 years from now, flops are free, okay? Even today, in some sense, flops are free. Okay, you can do extra computation. If you want to do 2x the computation, if you can reduce the amount of data movement to half, it's probably worthwhile to do that. Okay, It'll be even more true in the next 10 years, but it's already true today. Heavier processor density is one reason for that. Memory technologies integrated with processor technology is another example of what we are trying to do to essentially reduce this gap. Okay, we cannot just keep moving data all over the place. Okay, one example is that if I have a bunch of three levels of caches, okay, I want to compute on that data. If I have to fetch that to the third level cache, then second level, first level registers do some computation, probably too much data movement for that one flop of operation. People are also thinking of trends where, do I need to move the data to the processor to do the computation? Can I move the processing to the data and have some form of a processing unit, probably a weaker processing unit, sitting on memory that can do some lightweight computation for me? Okay, so if I have to do a very small amount of computation, it's cheaper for me to move my computation to that closer to the data on this lighter weight processor than getting that memory to my main processor to do the computation. Couple of things I want to mention with respect to implicit caches versus scratchpad memories. This is another important aspect that is becoming more and more prominent. If you think of your Intel architectures or AMD architectures, IBM architectures, most of these are essentially implicit caches in the sense that the cache is hidden. You never see the cache, okay? When you think of it from a computer architecture perspective, you are writing data essentially to memory, but somehow the hardware magically makes it look like as much faster memory. Okay, it fetches the bytes to cache. You can write the read or write from cache, and you can flush it. The hardware flushes it back when it's not needed. Okay, so in some sense, it's all hidden. The hardware is managing it for you. Okay, it's very very convenient as a programmer. Okay, now, as I mentioned, that's very expensive. Can be very expensive if, for example, the hardware does not know exactly what your access pattern is. A simple example of that is a strided vector. If I'm going on a vector unit, I'm only accessing one byte, probably not touch the rest of the cache line. I jump to the next strided of the vector. I don't touch the rest of the cache line. Okay? It's a very common example of where hardware logic might not be quite there to support your application. Okay, so in such an example, you are essentially fetching the entire cache block each time. You are accessing only a double, let's say. Okay, so that's very very expensive. So many architectures are moving to this model of explicit caches, or sometimes known as scratchpad memories, where the movement of data from memory to a cache-like memory is explicitly handled in software through an instruction. Okay, you issue an instruction. You say, I want these bytes to be fetched and put in this scratchpad memory. Okay, and there are instructions that will allow you to do chained as well, so you can do a strided thing. It's all software managed, so you can do whatever you like. You can add another extra instruction to make it more irregular if you like, okay, depending on what your application likes. Okay, so it's not as convenient in some sense as an implicitly managed cache, but it can be extremely more power efficient for these type of accesses, irregular accesses, okay? Not a contiguous access to memory. Just, I want to talk two more things about memory. One is memory reliability. A lot of systems today in laptops, right? Okay, most of these laptops don't have ECC protected memory. They have regular memory, okay? Now, on servers, on HPC machines, however, most systems use ECC memory. Okay, the cost is quite a bit more, but that's because of the scale, and a single bit flip can cause a lot of damage on a large system. So think of it this way, okay? On your laptop, if I told you that you have two options, option one, laptop A and laptop B. Laptop A, you have cheaper memory, non-protected memory, but every year or so, you'll have this Windows blue screen of death, or more contemporary Mac spinning wheel of death. Okay, it never happens on Linux, by the way. That's option A. Option B is you have a laptop which costs $1,000 more, and that never happens. Okay, this one, once a year you have this laptop crashing. The other one, you have nothing happens. It runs throughout your lifetime. Okay, which one do you prefer? Most people prefer option A. I can reboot my laptop once a year. It's not a problem, but I don't want to pay the $1,000 more. Okay. On scientific computing, when I have large-scale machines, if I have a bit flip as possible, I'm wasting a lot of compute cycles. Okay, so it might be worth investing that extra ECC money, ECC memory, to keep the machine on for a longer time. Okay, now With respect to exascale, if it, this might not be sufficient, okay? So if you talk to the Oak Ridge folks, Oak Ridge is a national lab, they mentioned that on their current system, every week or so, they see double bit flips, okay? Double bit flips are something ECC cannot catch today, okay? So even with the current superior memory, this every week or so, they see a double bit flip, okay? That's with today's system. If you, in fact, it's not even today's system. This was with the Jaguar system, their previous generation machine. Okay. As we move to exascale, this is going to become even more common, and we might see double bit flips, triple bit flips every day, okay, as the amount of memory increases. Now, we have the technology to fix this. Okay, it's not a technology problem. We have the technology to fix it. The problem is, if I add that technology, one, the acquisition cost of the memory will increase. Remember, memory is already half the machine cost. And two, the amount of power used by memory is going to increase. It's going to double, is the estimate. Okay, so we want to be a little bit careful. We say, should I just throw in hardware to make it more reliable? Or the other option is, can my application somehow detect that the error is, the data is inconsistent, and work around that, do more computation. Computation is free, right? Do more computation to work around that problem. So the last part I'm going to talk about is the network architectural trends. So a little bit of computer architecture 101 over here to describe how the network architecture. This is with current network architectures. I'll talk a little bit about what the future architectures are looking at, but just let's look at where we are today. Okay, we have a bunch of processors, a bunch of cores inside those. We have a bunch of memory DIMMs sitting on the side. There is the memory controller, the North Hub, whatever you want to call. There's an I/O bus or interconnect connecting that to the network adapter going out or the network switch. Okay, that's how the current architectures look like. Different bottlenecks are different places. There is the processing bottleneck sitting at the processor level. Whenever I have to send data, I have to do some processing of the data. I have to, you know, put my headers, I have to put a bunch of things on the data so that the remote process can understand what's going on. There's the I/O interconnect, which is becoming a bottleneck with respect to sending data to the network adapter. And finally, the network bottleneck of sending the data out on the raw speed of the network, or the wire itself. The reason I'm pointing this out is because the network, when we say about talk about the network interconnect speed, we're really not talking about this speed, okay? Of course, that's important, but that's not the only piece, okay? In fact, that's a very tiny piece of the overall network performance. All of the network performance mostly comes at these upper layers rather than the raw network link itself. Okay, so we need a balanced approach which deals with all of these in order to improve the user visible performance of the network. Okay, user visible performance is mostly those upper layers and not that bottom layer, though bottom layer plays a small part as well. Okay, so a quick description of where these things are. With respect to the processing speeds, earlier we were at about a gigabit per second. Ethernet 1979, a 10 megabit per second network was introduced, jumped to 100 megabit in 1993. Earlier, there was people thought that network was only for connection. It really didn't play a big role in the, you know, overall computation of the system. But then the big jump at that point came from 10 megabit per second to 100 megabit per second. And at that point, there's a renewed interest in networking, and there was a lot of new companies came up, ATM, Mirinet, which came up and came up with a 1 gigabit per second network. And till 1994, they got to 1 gigabit per second and, you know, stalled at that point. Okay, but that became a bottleneck for larger systems. With respect to the I/O interconnect, earlier technologies were like PCI and PCIX. They were bus-based technologies, so you have a bunch of wires and you have a clock speed increase, and you send data on all these wires in parallel. So they had issues with respect to clock skew, because if you keep the, if you increase the width of the bus from 128-bit to 256-bit and so on, there's a clock skew that's introduced between the wires. So the clock speed couldn't be increased because of this clock skew, and it was a major concern with respect to scalability of that. So that became an issue as well. And finally, with respect to protocol processing, the TCP IP, UDP IP, that's all old news that used to be used earlier, but essentially they could not drive the network even at, you know, slightly faster than a gigabit per second. They're starting to become a bottleneck because the processor itself was not able to drive the network fast enough. Okay, it was not because the computation was not enough. It was because of other reasons such as signaling and so on, and I can talk about that over lunch if you're interested. So where are the new trends going with respect to these new network architectures? Okay, so first thing we need to remember, we need to understand what is a bottleneck and what is not. Okay, the new technologies with respect to the high bandwidth technologies, network technologies like InfiniBand already give you rates of 14 gigabit per second per lane or 56 gigabit per second per network link, okay? And you can have multiple of these lanes, multiple of these links go out of your node. Or if you think of like a BlueJean or Cray type of architecture, you have on a Taurus, you have links going out on all over the, from all directions, like 6 or 10 links going out. So that can tremendously increase the bandwidth you're achieving, okay? So in some sense, mostly network bandwidth itself is not a bottleneck today, okay? Now, I say mostly because in some cases it is, but mainly because of congestion in the system, not because of the raw data each processor is sending out, okay? Network latency is still an issue, but that's a harder problem to solve. So to some people, it's a harder problem to solve. So I should tell something. There was, we have our director, Mark Snare, right? He was telling a story to someone saying that bandwidth is easy to optimize, okay? You just put more links, you get more bandwidth. It's the easy problem to solve. Latency is hard, it's physics, okay? So there was this MBA person sitting over there. He says, latency is easy. You just throw a few smart people on that, they'll fix it. Bandwidth is hard. It costs real money to improve that, okay? But anyway, we need to keep that in mind, okay? That's with respect to network technology, okay? So the bandwidth is not really much of a concern nowadays. With respect to I/O interface speeds, the traditional I/O buses, bus technology, PCI, PCIX, they are long gone, okay? Now, most systems don't use that at all. The newer I/O interconnect models are the PCIe Gen 1, Gen 2, Gen 3, and the HTX, the hypertransport from the hypertransport consortium. They are essentially leading the way with respect to most current machines, okay? They are theoretically infinite bandwidth, okay? I can talk separately with respect to why it's theoretically infinite bandwidth, but the basic idea is that they use multiple lane technology and each lane is an independent pair of wires. So they can increase the clock speed as much as they want because it's only two wires they have to care about, unlike buses, which can be 128 or 256 bit wide. And essentially, you're increasing the bandwidth by replicating these lanes, okay, or replicating the network links itself. It is still a band-aid solution for the I/O interconnect problem, but it's the most prominent band-aid available today, okay? Some vendors are looking at completely removing the I/O interconnect from the network critical path. They want to put the network itself on the processor chip, okay? So that there is no I/O interconnect. The network interconnect directly has access to the memory controller and essentially the memory, so it can move data directly from there instead of having to go through the I/O interconnect. Okay, and this has a lot of mass market backing, not because of high performance computing technologies, but because of wireless, okay, wireless technologies. When you have a wireless chip integrated on your processor, your cell phone is going to take lesser energy. Okay, so there is a lot of mass market backing for this processor integrated network technologies. It's not just a scientific computing thing, though in scientific computing, we really don't care about wireless, we care about real networks integrated on the processor chip. Okay. All right, one last slide with respect to the network protocol stacks. Most protocol stacks today are already offloaded onto the network hardware, okay? So your network layer, your transport layer, everything is hardware implemented in current networks, okay? Mostly hardware implemented in current networks, okay? What the new network technology trends are heading towards is feature offload, more feature offload. So they want to take things like the MPI implementations or PGAS, pieces of PGAS implementation and put those onto the network, okay? Because protocol offload itself is not sufficient if you have to build higher levels on top of the protocol like MPI or PGAS or whatever else it is, okay? Examples of that are put-get communication, are hardware supported today on almost every useful network. BlueJeans, Crays, InfiniBand, everything has hardware-supported put-get operations, okay, even atomic operations. Cray C-Star had support for hardware matching for MPI send receive type of operations. In fact, the next generation based on portals 4 is expected to have similar support for MPI send receive matching on the hardware as well. So important thing is increasing network specialization. Again, just like processor specialization, network specialization is an increasing trend for most new networks. So every time Mellanox releases a new network adapter or IBM comes up with their next machine, how the network is improving is not with respect to the raw speed. That's not, the raw bandwidth is not something we care about so much, but the features that they offload on hardware. Okay, for example, some vendors are thinking of offloading non-contiguous data movement onto hardware itself. Okay, some applications like NWChem, chemistry application, they are very intensive with respect to strided vector access. Okay, so if they can offload a strided vector access onto the hardware, that's a big win for such applications. So they are thinking of doing such things. Some new architectures like that, including the IBM BlueJeanQ architecture, are thinking of providing multiple hardware contexts. So you can think of it as SMT-like model on the network that will allow for many cores, threads on cores, to simultaneously access the network without having to stall for each other. Okay, so that, those kind of specializations are what vendors are thinking of for the next generation of network architectures. Okay. All right, almost done, 3 minutes, excellent. So to summarize, with every 10x increase in performance, something will break, okay? That's a guaranteed, that's a guarantee, okay? Now, in the past 20 years, we enjoyed a million times increase in performance, okay? Okay, we went to teraflop, we went to petaflop, we are at 30-ish petaflop at this point. A patchwork at every step is not going to cut it. We have to start thinking forward. We have to start thinking about what's coming up in the next 10 years, let's say, and aim our application. Our trajectory has to aim for where things will be rather than where things are today. And 30x increase in performance is going to be, another three things that are going to break, or not three things, 1.3 things that are going to break. So, so we have to keep that in mind. We have to keep these technologies in mind, and applications that you're building today have to keep this in mind to, to be architected for the systems that will be coming out in 2020, okay? Interesting times both for architecture as well as for applications. That's all, can take questions. Yes.
Going back to power consumption and liquid cooling systems, are there any systems which are reusing the heat extracted including the power?
The question was, are there any systems that are reusing the heat that that is coming out of the systems? There are experimental systems, but I don't know of a production system that does that. It's too hard to, somehow convert the heat back to power, but at least efficiently. But I did hear of a old machine. This was at the, I don't know if you guys know of the Green Destiny time in Los Alamos. At that time, there was a company that bought it called Orion Multisystems. They were experimenting with something with respect to trying to reuse that heat. I don't know the details of that. I can look it up, but something like that they were experimenting. But I don't think it's a production system, though. Other questions? Yes.
Going back to the locked cores, are there many systems that will?
Which cores?
When you lock the cores on the CPU, towards the beginning of the talk.
Lock the cores. Not locked, but yeah, they are not powered on. Yeah.
Are there any use cases that try and, if you could power them on, they attempt to power them on?
If you talk to the IBM guys, they don't want to disclose that at all. They don't want to talk about the 18th core at all, because they know that if they mention that to a computational scientist, he will want to use it. So they don't want to mention that. It's not there. As far as you're concerned, it doesn't exist. Too much power, they can't power it on. Other questions? So I should point out that the Intel, I don't know what they call, the turbo mode is something similar to that, but that you can control a little better. Okay, I'm out of time.
Thank you.
Thank you.